Let's begin to bless the Lord this evening. Let's thank Him for bringing us into His presence. In the presence of the Lord, there is the fullness of joy. Father, we are excited to be in Your presence. We're happy that You have brought us into Your house this evening. Open your mouth and begin to bless His name. Give Him praise. Worship His name. Celebrate Him. He is a faithful God. He is a merciful God. Is there any living soul in this house? Open your mouth and begin to bless the Lord. Give Him praise. Exalt His holy name. Celebrate His name. Worship His name. King of kings, we bless You. King of kings, we worship You. We bow to You. We exalt You. We honor You because You are a faithful God. Thank You for bringing us into Your presence. You're a merciful God. You're an awesome God. Today is the last day of the month of March 2019. Our quantum leap. The first quarter has been an awesome season, and You are preparing us to step into a new season. We want to thank You in advance and bless Your holy name and give You glory and honor You because You deserve our worship. You deserve our worship. You deserve our praise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Let's begin to commit ourselves to the hands of God. Father, open me up to Your word. Open me up to Your word. The Bible says, forever, O Lord, Thy word is settled in heaven. Lord, open my life to receive You. Let me receive that life-changing encounter, contact with You, that will radically change the course of history of my life. Father, I want to meet with You today. I want to meet with You today. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain into my life today. Let Your word break me free from every impediment, every obstacle, every obscurity, everything that limits me. Father, I want to receive from You. I want to receive from You. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. I want you to begin to ask the Lord that you want to hear something that will move you into the new season. We're entering into a new month, a new quarter tomorrow. So, Lord, prepare me with Your word for this new season. The season of supernatural divine rains. Lord, prepare me with Your word. Open your mouth and begin to pray. Lord, I don't want to remain the same. I don't want to be on the same level. I ask that there be a change of life, a change of level, a change of status spiritually and in every aspect of my life by the reason of Your word. I pray that I will receive the word that will move me into a new season. That is my heart desire. That is my prayer. I ask, Lord, that You will equip me by Your spirit. Equip me by Your spirit. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. I don't know how many of us got the message to wait on the Lord today. This is the second consecutive month that we started wait on the Lord this year. The last day of the month, we shared that every last day of the month is like the eve, the way we say Christmas Eve, New Year's Eve. And we laid the foundation from Psalm 110 verse 3 that there is what they call the womb of the morning. Every day is pregnant, giving birth to the next day. And in the night seasons, a lot of things happen. So, but spiritually, we can program the day. we can decide how tomorrow is going to look like today in the place of prayer. The Bible says, this is the day the Lord has made, and I will rejoice. That means God can decide to make the day go in a certain direction. We're going to pray and speak into tomorrow and into the month of April and into the month of May and June, because we're entering into the second quarter of the year. Let us begin to prophesy into this new season. Open your mouth and begin to pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I speak into the month of April. Let the month of April bring me affluence. I speak into the month of May. Let the month of May bring me miracles. I speak into the month of June. Let the month of June bring justice into my life. I speak into this new season of supernatural divine rains, that you will open up my destiny to receive fresh fire from you, fresh anointing, fresh grace, fresh insight in the name of Jesus. I might be able to carry out that which you have called me to carry out with ease in the name of Jesus. I pray for the equipment of your spirit. I pray for the infilling of your power. I pray for the ordination of your grace. Let your grace be upon me. Let your might be upon me. Let the power of the Holy Spirit be upon me. Lord, I want to be able to receive. I want to be able to be equipped by your power. In the mighty name of Jesus, I want to receive. I want to receive from you. I want to be equipped by you. Supernaturally soak me as I enter into a new season. I don't want to play religion. I don't want to be the same person, just feeling some emotional highs. I want a tangible manifestation of your presence in my life, in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. The Bible talks about, it said there were 10 lepers that were healed. But how many of them were whole? 10 lepers were healed. How many were whole? One. We're praying and saying, Lord, we don't just want to taste miracles. We want to live in it. Praise the Lord. There are people who give testimony once in a year. But there are people who actually live in the supernatural. That is what our testimony want to be. I don't know about you. I started going to church as in being born again when I was 14. And I'm almost 40. That's a very long time. And I've seen all kinds of service in the house of God. Believe you me, I am tired of faking it. I like it when I have an experience, a tangible one. And when you meet God, you will know you have met God. Praise the Lord. The Bible says on the road to Damascus, Saul, when he saw the light, he could not but fall. And he asked, who art thou, Lord? Lord, give me an encounter. In this quarter that I'm entering, give me a solid state encounter with you. I want to experience you personally. I want to know the depths of your power. In my life, in 2019, give me a life-changing encounter. Open your mouth and begin to pray. Open your mouth and seek the face of God. Seek the face of God. In the name of Jesus. Seek the face of God this evening. Lord, an encounter, an extraordinary encounter with you. Holy Spirit of God, until you move. I don't want to move out of this place. I want to feel your power. I want to experience you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Pray. Praise the Lord. When you have not seen money, you may think that money is your problem. But I can tell you that there are people who are in money and they are still calling for help. Because no material thing can satisfy the soul. The shape of the soul is a God-shaped vacuum that only God can fill. food can just temporarily satisfy. That's the reason why no matter how much you eat, tomorrow you will still eat. Huh? No matter how much you eat, tomorrow you will still eat. But Jesus, by the well, told the woman that there is a water that I will give you. When you take this water, you will never thirst again. Praise the Lord. He told them that this bread that I will give you, when you eat it, you will never be hungry again. That's the kind of experience I want to have. Living heaven on earth. I am on earth, but I'm in heaven because of the kind of experience. Is it possible? Is it possible? That's what the Bible says. It says, in your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. It didn't say for a season. It's possible. This evening I wanted to ask the Lord, I said, Lord, give me an experience of heaven on earth. A lasting experience of heaven on earth. Help me to taste your power. Help me to taste your anointing. Help me to taste your glory. Help me to taste the Spirit of Christ. Help me to taste your love. Help me to taste your power. Help me to taste your glory. Open your mouth and pray. Help me to taste your glory. Lord, reveal yourself to me. Reveal yourself to me. Reveal your power to me. Reveal your power to me. I want to feel you, Jesus. I want to experience you, Spirit of God. I want to know you, Spirit of God. I want you to possess every aspect of my life. I want you to possess every aspect of my being. Just you, Jesus, is all I want in my life. In my life, all I want is you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Praise the Lord. You know, one of the reasons why you hardly hear me pray prayers and say, let's begin to bind Satan and all of that, is because Satan is not on your level spiritually. The Bible says we are seated where? How did the Bible put it? We are seated in heavenly places. High above what? So where is Satan? He's under you. You don't begin to pray and bind ants that you are stepping on. The problem is not Satan, it's us. You won't hear all through the preaching of Jesus, say, oh please, let's gather Satan and tie in rope. Or the apostles, you won't hear anything like that. Because if left for you and Satan, Satan will squeeze you. But Jesus said, behold, I give unto you what? The keys of the kingdom. He said, I have bruised Satan under your feet. I have done it all. It is finished. You go out and spread my word. In fact, when you find him, trample on him. That's what the scripture says. So, you know, Africans, we like to pray those kind of prayers. After we pray and bind spirits, we bind ourselves because we are actually the problem. Praise the Lord. Honestly, ever since my prayer life changed, I just discovered that life became easier for me. There were maybe like 10 years ago, there was a time we were praying enemies of my father's house. I don't know whether you ever prayed that prayer. Enemies of my father's house. And all through I prayed this prayer, nobody died in my father's house, as in trying to look for who the wicked person. You know, they will tell you, some pastor will tell you, after praying, check, you will hear news that somebody is dead. Praise the Lord. Ignorance. Am I saying that there are no witchcraft or there are no satanic activities? No, that's what I'm saying. The Bible says, even if you drink any deadly thing, it will not what? Hurt you. That's what it's saying. If somebody do juju around your body, the one you drank didn't hurt you. Is it the one that touched your body that will hurt you? Do you understand what I'm saying? We can live in an environment that is dirty, but we don't want to drink or eat something that is dirty because our internals are more sensitive, more susceptible to infection. So what God wants us to do is a change of our mindset. And the instrument is nothing else than the word of God that we are receiving here. As we're receiving this word, say, Lord, I want to be able to believe everything you say. Believe it. Because I can as well say that a lot of the challenges we face is the level of belief. Should I take that step? I don't want to take that step now. The thing didn't work. The level of belief we have. Praise the Lord. So lastly, let's open our mouths and pray and say, Lord, minister to me in this service. Minister to me in this service. At the season of the word, let my spiritual understanding be open to you. At the season of the word, let my spiritual understanding be open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth and pray. Let my spiritual understanding be open by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. You're the one, you are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give a healing and grace. Our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Spirit of God, we welcome you into this house. We ask that you will speak to everyone here today in a language that we will understand. We pray that you know the issues of our lives. You know where we need you more than ever. We pray that your word will minister to us in that specific area of our life that we need you in Jesus' name. We ask that the word, like manna, will be the solution to that problem in our life. We pray that through the word, we will stand on the mountaintop over all the challenges of our life in Jesus' name. Spirit of God, use both the speaker and the hearers to be a blessing to your house in Jesus' name. Thank you for answering us. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Some people are not saying amen. 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 Praise the Lord. If you are fasting, doesn't mean that you should be angry. Praise the Lord. Fasting is not necessarily beneficial to God. It is essentially a benefit to us. Because what fasting does, it purifies our sensitivity. It puts us in a condition where we hunger for God. Praise the Lord. Let me start with Matthew 7. Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 7. Are you in Matthew 7? Matthew 7 verse 13. It says, "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat." You also find that in Luke 13:24. Then verse 14 says, "Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I just read that to encourage us. Sometimes you, in your course of serving God, you think that you are going to be having a lot of people following you in your journey. Many a times at the startup of life in the spirit, you find a lot of people, friends, colleagues following you, but there comes a point in time that you begin to notice that the number of people following you is what? Is going down, and you begin to wonder whether you are actually doing the right thing. But I read that to make you know that the road where God is calling us to go is not a road that is going to be popular. It didn't start today, it started way back. I shared with us that there was a time when about 4,988 people left Jesus' ministry in one day. Praise the Lord. The 5,000 who saw him fed the multitudes. They came and he said, "This time, you're going to eat my flesh." They said, "We're not prepared for that one." And they left. It was 12 people that were left. The disciples, essentially. So, the service of God, I mean, over the weekend, I was sharing something with my wife. Sometimes you hear some very discouraging news, but you remind yourself that this race, I must finish it. The Bible says, "No man puts his hand on the plow and looks back that is fit for the kingdom." So it's a journey that requires all your attention. During wartime, some of the soldiers that you practice together, they can be shot. It does not mean that the battle will not continue. The battle must continue. The battle must go on. Praise the Lord. So, I want to ask you this question. Are you ready to keep going even when it gets tough? Are you ready to keep going even when it gets tough? That is what we are going to be seeing in these last days. In these last days, the Bible says men shall be lovers of themselves more than lovers of God. That means people will give priority to what pertains to them than to that which pertains to God. You will see more drive towards entertainment, towards pleasure, towards self-gratification. But when it comes to spiritual matters and things of the kingdom, you will see cold feet. It's there. It's there in the scriptures. And that's going to be the characteristics of the end time church. There will be a falling away from the faith. The Bible says that the Spirit speaks expressly that many will depart from the faith. What does it mean? It means that a lot of people who probably have started that walk with you will go back. Praise the Lord. I said with us when this year was beginning that 2019 a lot of pressure will be put on families. Do you remember I said it? A lot of pressures. If you listen to news, you will hear a lot of happenings that really indicate that we are in the end time and we have to discipline ourselves, encourage ourselves in the Lord. Having said that, we've been on the series of the Kingdom of God, and last week we looked at the wealth and the resources of the Kingdom of God. That's 2 weeks ago. Last week, was it last week? Okay, I was here. I felt that I was abroad. Praise the Lord. Okay, so we looked at the wealth and the resources of the Kingdom of God, and an amazing time, because we said that everything on earth belongs to God. And as children of God, we have access by faith. Praise the Lord. We have access. As a matter of fact, the things of the resources of the Kingdom of God is on a need basis. When you need it, it will be available by faith. So God does not necessarily give you a bank account and give you lots of money and say, go out. In fact, what Jesus told disciples, he said, when you are going now, don't go with anything. Huh? But as you go, it will be what? Provided for. So that's the difference between how we carry out heaven's assignment or the assignment of men. For men, everything you need, they will give you physically. But for God, he says, go with faith and I will provide. Has he failed? He has never failed. Praise the Lord. So today we'll be looking at the nature of the Kingdom of God. The nature of the Kingdom of God. I've been trying to compress our study on the Kingdom of God as much as possible. So we'll be covering a number of things today, though very, very short study. On the nature of the Kingdom of God, we'll look at the definition, which refers to the composition, structure, pattern, style, or system of administration and operation of the Kingdom of God. There are a lot of operations that go on in the Kingdom of God. We're going to see some of them. Another word for operation is activities that go on in the Kingdom of God. What and what we should be concerned about. There are a lot of things that happen in the Kingdom of God that God doesn't really want us to bother about. Praise the Lord. Like, we shouldn't be bothered about the, how will I put it now? What happens in the spiritual realm? How witches operate? Level 999, level 666, you know? A lot of people, their lectures are on demonology. You don't need it. You understand what I'm saying? There are a lot of books that are written on how witches and wizard operates, their meetings, the time of their meeting. Do you want to attend? The venue and the materials they use to do witchcraft. You don't need all of those information. We'll look at forbidden knowledge, what the Bible describes as forbidden knowledge. Certain knowledge that if knowing them will do you more harm than good. Praise the Lord. I was sharing with someone some days back, and I said, when we talk about violation, or when we say someone is violated, defiled, we mostly attach it to mean a lady that is a virgin, that is no longer a virgin because someone probably did something to her. Now, I want you to know that it's not only restricted to that scenario. There are certain information you hear that defiles you. Many of us will probably have watched certain videos that has been moving on maybe WhatsApp or YouTube. They are beheading somebody. Have you ever seen a video like that? Huh? You're already violated because there is a purity that we have. We've not seen certain kind of evil things, but now we've seen all kinds. We're not even talking about pornographic images, which is literally everywhere on the internet. Praise the Lord. When you check your Yahoo mail, there's a section they call the spam mails. Most of it are filled with pornographic materials. You didn't subscribe to them, but they are there. Thank God for Yahoo that, and some of these email clients that help you to control unsolicited message. So if the address is suspicious, they will send it to the spam box that I don't think is... Whenever you send mails to more than 30 or 50 persons, those mail clients will suspect that it is not likely to be a genuine mail. Because most of the messages we send it to individuals, isn't it? Praise the Lord. That's just a digression. So, the nature of the kingdom of God defines the operations of God in all the spheres of life. What God does, what God wants us to do. The kingdom, as we know it, will be incomplete without some of these key things that we'll mention today. So, we basically have the nature or composition of the kingdom of God grouped into two, spiritual and physical. We operate in this dual realm. We are physical beings, but we are essentially spirits. Praise the Lord. They will say man is a spirit living in a body with a soul. So whatever, however you like it, we always operate in these two realms, spirit, the spirit realm, and in the physical realm. In the physical realm, man, animals, the earth itself, what they call the four elements of life, earth, water, wind, and fire, and all the natural resources, they are all on the earth space. Everything in life can be grouped into these things. Anything you see is either it is an animal or a plant, or it is a human being, or it is a breakdown of the earth. Either fire, water, natural substances. Praise the Lord. Then spiritually, we have God, angels, heaven itself, and the spiritual resources of heaven. When we talk about spiritual nutrients, in the physical realm, we will talk about manganese, potassium, calcium, and the rest. In the spirit realm, we talk about the Word of God. Okay? We talk about the Word of God. Open to 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1, the Bible talks about the spiritual vitamins, which we could call the resources of the kingdom of God. The spiritual resources that are made available. Are you in 2 Peter chapter 1? Somebody talk to me. I had a preacher. He said, open the book of Genesis. And then he said, if you are still looking for Genesis, something is wrong with you. Because Genesis is supposed to be the most, one of the easiest books to find. But we're actually looking at 2 Peter today. 2 Peter chapter 1. From verse 6 or 5. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to your virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience kindness, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. Verse 8. If these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, he's saying that there are things that will be in you that will make sure you are not spiritually barren. So when we mention that spiritual resources, the word of God, fast and prayer, spiritual warfare are like vitamins of the spirit. Okay? How many of you have ever had a time when your lips, you had cracks on your lip, and they told you that you lacked vitamin C? And as you took vitamin C, in 2 days, that crack started disappearing. Spiritually speaking, there are things that we do to be exposed to the devil's attack. Satan, demons, and hell, they are part of the spiritual components. Now, the reason why we're taking the time to break down the teaching on the kingdom of God is so that you will understand what Christianity is all about. What is going on in the world today? There is so much emphasis on certain things that shouldn't be the items on which we emphasize. We live our Christian life, and we seem to still be under the siege of Satan, because the devil wants us to emphasize what is not meant to be emphasized. The devil wants you to feel that the problem that you are having is maybe because you are from Africa. You know, there are people who believe that if they were born in America, there will be no problem in their life. The devil wants you to feel that if you change location, maybe if you travel to Canada, every problem you have will be solved. I agree that your light problem and your NEPA bad road problem will be solved, but you will realize that a greater problem followed you from here there. Praise the Lord. So I want you to, so that you won't take temporary solutions to your problem. You will actually take the word permanent solution, which is Jesus Christ in your life. Satan, demons, hell, all these things we mentioned, they are common. Any part of the world you travel to, Satan is there. He doesn't even have to open a branch office. It's the same office he's running. Praise the Lord. God is everywhere. There is no part of the world you go to that you have less of God or more of God than you have God. Anyway, he's everywhere. There was a joke many years ago. They said it is that to call hellfire from US was like $3,000. But from Nigeria to hellfire was 1 naira, because it's a local call. I don't know that you understand what it means. The distance, the more expensive your phone call becomes. Of course, you don't pay the same rate if you call America. It's not the same rate when you call within Nigeria. So they were trying to say that Nigeria and hellfire is as good as the same. But I want you to understand that the enemies we fight is common to every human being, common to every part of the world you find yourself. So God is at the heart of everything in the kingdom of God. God is at the heart. That is why in Psalm 139, David said, "Where will I go from your presence?" He even said, "If I make my bed in hell," what did he say? He said, "You are there. If I hide in darkness," he said, "darkness is perfect light to you." I cannot hide from the presence of God. God is everywhere. And I explained to us that the reason why God is everywhere is because he created all things. So he's essentially, he has his nature in everything. He has his nature in everything. Wouldn't it amaze you in Job chapter 1 that when Satan came to present himself before God, and he said, God said, "Have you considered my servant Job?" What did Satan say? He said, "The one that you have protected." And then God said, "I have given you freedom to touch him, but don't take his life. Why do you think that Satan will obey God? Have you ever wondered why Satan went and carried out exactly the instruction God gave him? He said, because he's under his control. He cannot go beyond that control. If you've ever been to Bar Beach, I don't know what that beach is. If you go to Bar Beach, you'll notice that the water comes. And when it's with all the energy, it will get to that place and do what? The Bible says in Psalm 104, it said, I have given the waters decree that they should not go beyond. That was the kind of instruction God gave to Satan. So God is at the heart of everything. Praise the Lord. That is, we just mentioned that to say that without God, there will be no kingdom of God, because we call it the kingdom of God. And then the other essentials of the kingdom of God is what? Man and angels. Man, because all the authority of God on earth has been given to who? Angels, because angels are the ministering spirits between the spiritual realm and the physical realm. Man cannot go to heaven the way we are now. But angels operate on both the what? Spiritual realm and the physical realm. Many times in scriptures, angels appeared and sent messages to men. In fact, some of them were given things to eat. So, these are the essentials. Now, the non-essentials of the kingdom of God, what are they? Huh? Satan, demons, sin, sickness, disease, corruption, death, darkness, and so on and so forth. They are non-essentials. The kingdom of God can exist without them. As a matter of fact, our mandate is to ensure that they are what? That they are expunged from the kingdom of God. That they are removed. Every of the things you see there now has an expiring date. Satan has a final date of judgment. How many of you? In the calendar of God, there is a date where Satan will cease his operation. He will be jailed for life. Are you glad to know that?
Yes.
I will want to be alive then. To be in a world where there is no Satan. It will be an amazing thing. A world where there are no demons. And do you know what it means? When there are no Satan and demons, there will also be no sin. Because who is the agent of sin? It's Satan now. He's the one that parades, look for, see that money, take him, take that money, take that money. He's the devil. Sickness, disease. Imagine you going to the hospital. Would there even be need for hospitals? There'll be no need for hospitals. Hospitals will just be a place to go and give birth. Eh? Just give birth and, I mean, people just say, how now? The woman that just gave birth 2 minutes ago say, but I want to eat shawarma. Excited. No, all these, their names, they call. You know, when you go to the hospital, you hear names that you never had before. Low blood count, high blood pressure, and all kinds of names. No sickness and disease. It's a world to behold. Imagine Nigeria without corruption. You know what it will mean? It will mean that as you finish church now, you just come out. You will see a cab waiting for you. And they will take, the cab will just take you home. How much will you pay? 10 naira. What a world. Can you imagine that kind of system? Because government will use all the resources to do what? For the people. Nobody is going to loot any money. Just thinking of it alone, it sounds like heaven. And you know, that's what it's meant to be. So, if I were you, I would devote my life to making sure all of these things don't exist. The Bible says that the Son of God manifested that he might what? Destroy the works of the devil. These are the works of the devil. Death. First Corinthians chapter 15 talks about death is one of the enemies that will be defeated. The last enemy that will be defeated is death. There will be no more death. Once a person is born, you live forever. That's how it's meant to be. You live forever. Praise the Lord. Okay, so we'll look at the structure of the kingdom of God. There are three heavens. For those of you who didn't go to Bible school, or let me put it this way, for some of us that didn't go to Bible school, let's be learning some of the things they teach them, so that we'll rub shoulders with them. Praise the Lord. There are three heavens. The first heaven is, or rather, let me start with the third heaven. The third heaven is where God dwells. There are many scriptures, but I just gave one, Psalm 11 verse 4. The heaven is the place where God dwells. The third heaven. The second heaven is where the angels dwell. Now, some angels actually dwell in God's presence. Praise the Lord. And they are the archangels, the cherubim, the seraphim. They dwell in the presence of God. Angel Gabriel, Angel Michael. I think it was Gabriel who said, I'm coming from the very presence of God. So I'm not one of the what do they call it now? The angels that stay in barracks. That's it. You know, when you hear the host of heaven is referring to what? The second heaven. That's where the military might of heaven is. But there are angels who actually dwell in God's presence. They see the face of the Father all the time. Including angels, our children's angel, because the Bible says they behold the Father's face. Okay? All of us have angels, so it's just that some of us, we are struggling with our angel. When they say don't do this, you want to do it, so the angel itself is tired. But for children, they are helpless. Praise the Lord. And then we have the first heaven, which is the expanse between Earth's atmosphere and space. This is actually where demons operate from. So Satan and his agents, they operate from our atmosphere. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1 and 2, it says the prince of the power of the air. It's talking about the location of the devil. And I also told us sometimes ago that when Daniel prayed for 21 days, his answers were delayed because the prince of Persia withstood his prayer in the air. That is talking about the first heaven. So when you look out of the window, what you see is what? First heaven. We call it atmosphere, but it's beyond atmosphere. It also includes the space. And space can be almost immeasurable, very large. Very large. And then from the earth, what do we have? We now have earth. Can I get a marker? I don't know. So we have earth. Humans dwell. We all are all on earth. Any part of the world is the earth. Including people who built house underground. They are living on earth. There's no depth you can go underground that you will leave earth. You'll still be on earth. Okay? And then we have under the earth where all the unsaved dead are imprisoned until the judgment day. Anybody that have died since creation, especially that were not saved, they are imprisoned in the earth. Unfortunately, or fortunately, is not a physical place, but the location is on the earth. Yes, under the earth. Some demons are imprisoned here. According to 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. Let me read that place. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. It says, for if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell, and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment. I don't know, have I ever said to us that there are demons that are more powerful than Satan? Have I ever told us? You've not heard it. Okay, so hear it today. There are some demons that actually are more powerful than Satan. Satan is a music angel. Is an angel designed to sing and worship God. There are angels that are designed to fight. So when soldier and musician meet, I mean, you don't need to know the difference. So these angels were so, they are so powerful that, give me blue. Ocean of Grace is blue. Let's do blue. When we are doing sick, we do red. Praise God. There are angels, these angels are so powerful that God did not allow them to remain free the way Satan is free. As soon as they fell from heaven, they were chained. They were imprisoned. Because if they were allowed to be on the earth, in few minutes the earth will be over. I'll give you proof of that. Revelation. Praise the Lord. In Revelation, this thing, is it connected? In Revelation, the Bible talks about an angel, a demon that was released, and in the space of 30 minutes, one third of the world was destroyed. The name of that angel is called Abaddon. Abaddon means destruction. Another name is Apollyon. That demon will not be released until the time of the Great Tribulation. So right from the day the demon fell, not just him, you know, Satan fell from heaven. How many of you know that? He fell with some demons, a lot of them who joined his league. Among the demons that fell, there were demons that were more powerful than him. So immediately they were chained. They were jailed. Satan was allowed, and many of his colleagues. Praise the Lord. Those ones are not as powerful. But during the Great Tribulation, a number of those powerful demons will be released. As soon as they are released, there will be serious destruction on the earth. Let me quickly show us that structure of the kingdom so that we just have here. We have something like this. This is a third heaven. Second. First. Earth. And under the earth. So God stays here. Angels. When you hear God, what are you asking again? I should put S here, gods. Once you say I'm a worshipper of God, I mean, what are you talking about? You're a worshipper of Christ, isn't it? Earth, man, unsaved, dead, and some demons are imprisoned here. Praise the Lord. Okay, so let's move on. We have the governance of the kingdom of God as part of the composition of the kingdom of God. The kind of government that God runs is called what? It's called theocracy. It's borrowed from democracy, as in when we hear democracy, democracy is government of the people, by the people, for the people. But in theocracy is government by God, for God. It's the government of God, for God, by God. It's all about God. You know, when you hear things like this, it doesn't sound too sweet, because it's like we don't have any place. It's like we don't have any relevance. Revelation chapter 4 verse 11 says, they all things were created They were created for what? For whose pleasure? For God's pleasure. So, I want you to know that this whole world and everything happening about this world is not about you. It's about somebody, about God. It is not about you. Tell yourself, it's not about me. It's about God. It's about His kingdom. It's about His will. So, if I want to have some significance, what do? I line up with God. And that's how we say the government of God for God, by God, and the people He has chosen to what? To govern with Him. It's all about Him, but God has decided that some of us should govern with Him. And He has opened this invitation. So when you get saved, you are privileged to come into governance with Him. Do you understand that? You come into governance with Him. The reason why it's important to state this is for some people that it's all about them, and so God will do everything possible to make sure that their life succeeds. No, it's all about Him. It's all about Him. When you get this image clear in your mind, the way you live your life will be different. Everything you own, everything you are doing is all about the glory of God, for the glory of His name. Seek ye first His kingdom. And all these other things will be added. It's all about Him. He's the principal. He is the chief of the kingdom. And we are all His subjects. We are to worship Him. We are to serve Him with our lives. God choosing some humans to govern with Him is an exclusive privilege of what? Of grace. The Bible says that no man comes to the Father except the Father draws him. Jesus said that. He said, no man comes to me except he is drawn by the Father. So when we say that I gave my life to Christ, in essence, what are you saying? Huh? Christ gave you the opportunity to be saved. You didn't give your life to Christ. Do you know who Christ is that you give your life to Him? What do you know about Him? We all got saved in ignorance. In ignorance, we were all in sin, and somehow the cords of grace started pulling us, and we found ourselves in the midst of the people of God and said, we want to serve God. Do you know there are people out there desiring to know God, but it just appears that grace has not found them? Praise the Lord. And that's the reason why we are called to pray. So that the gospel of Jesus Christ can reach people. How long did the children of Israel continue to pray and ask for the help of God? They were asking for the help of God for 430 years until God sent Moses to go and rescue them. So, he whom the Father draws has a responsibility to fulfill all of the Father's demands. You are privileged to be saved by grace. Ephesians chapter 2 tells us that by grace are ye saved, not of works, lest any man should boast. It is not your service to God that is important to God. It's the fact that Jesus had bridged that gap. You now have a relationship. It's like your children. Come on, they were just born into your home. Huh? And then they are privileged to have everything. Sometimes they misbehave, but you can't throw them out. They are still your children. That's how we are privileged to be born into the kingdom of God, into this amazing relationship. It's an amazing thing. And believe you me, I want you to cherish it. I want you to cherish your relationship with God. It's better than anything. I know some of you, you'll be rolling on the floor if tomorrow they said that there is a connection between you and Dangote that is your uncle. or the guy, he even puts advert on TV that he's been looking for you, that there was a mistake during the time you were born. One woman claimed you that said it's your mother, that you're actually from Dangote's line. How many of you will not give testimony? Ah, mommy, I love you, but now my real mother and I be that good wife. Praise God. Why? Because you feel that, man, I am now in money. Do you know that's how we are connected with Christ? We are brothers and sisters in Christ, the same Father. The Bible says we are all joint heirs with Him. Everything Jesus owns, we are sharing it with Him. Don't you feel excited? The ramifications, the implication is so heavy when you realize that we share the same resources, the same bond with Jesus Christ to the Father. It's an amazing experience. It takes the whole stress of life off you. The same way somebody will hear that if you get an alert of 4 million naira now, some of you, even if you have malaria, you'll be healed. By the time you see the alert, confirm that is your own. Then the bank called and says your own, bros. It's okay. The whole year is, you're excited. But we have much more than that. What we have is much more than that. So that moves us to, we have what we call a shared responsibility with the Father to carry out His will on the earth. There's this phrase that Bishop Oyedepo normally mentions, and I totally agree with him. He says that any faith that makes God absolutely responsible for the consequences of your life, the outcomes of your life, is an irresponsible faith, and that's the truth. Many of us think that if God is going to bless you, there's nothing you have to do, the blessing will just happen. Now let me rephrase. If any positive thing is going to happen in your life, you have no step, you have nothing to contribute. It's not true. I told us before that in terms of blessing, we've already been what? We've already been blessed. But the workings of your life, the day-to-day outcomes of your life, you must participate. And that takes us to what we call the shared responsibility of the kingdom. Praise the Lord. Okay, it says, the will of God is the moral code by which heaven runs and by which it should run. Heaven and earth ran by the will of God or the word of God until the earth fell short of the glory of God as a result of the fall of Adam in the Garden of Eden. The word of God is the constitution of heaven and earth. I explained to us, the Bible is not the word of God. The Bible contains. Do you understand English? Praise the Lord. So, because some of you, when you take the Bible and open it like this, anyway, I want to read, and the next thing you see, you just see, take the knife and go and stab her. You say, oh boy, this one will be God. The Bible is not the word of God, like we say. Yes, the Bible is the word of God. But I'm saying the word of God is contained inside the Bible. When you read the Bible, you will now begin to understand which words, which phrases are actually the very words of God. Praise the Lord. As a matter of fact, sometimes you won't hear somebody like Paul. Paul will tell you that, I, not the Lord. Trying to tell you that this one, don't put this on the same level though. Inside the word of God, Satan also spoke. Demons spoke. Spirits, different things spoke. But you will know the word of God. And thank God for these modern Bibles. You have this translation that puts the words of Christ in red in the New Testament. I wish they would also do the same for the Old Testament. So you will now see the very words of God. So the word of God is the constitution of heaven and earth. Mind you, I didn't say the Bible. That's why I took time to explain. The Bible is not the constitution of heaven and earth. It is what? The word of God. So when you go to heaven, this Bible you are carrying, you won't find it in heaven. what you will find in heaven is the word of God that is inside this Bible that will be there. Every other thing is the, what do we call it now? The padding for what we have. God the Father is the chief administrator of the kingdom of God. The mediator between man and God is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ's sacrificial death on the cross made it possible for sinful men to have an eternal relationship with the Most Holy One, God the Father. Jesus is the person who can take rubbish. Let me put it that way. Do you understand what I'm saying? Jesus can take what? He can take rubbish, in quotes. In fact, Jesus said that if you sin against me, there's forgiveness. But if you sin against the Holy Spirit, there's no forgiveness. So, God the Father cannot take rubbish. And that's the reason why I said, when they discussed in heaven, you know, when you read the scriptures, you will see, let us go. Let us make man in our own image. First one, that's in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. The second time is in Genesis chapter 11, verse 1 and 2. It says, let us go down and confuse their language. When you hear the us, it's talking about the three in one. God the Father is too holy to behold iniquity. But Jesus can take some level of it. Why? Because he is both God and... Do you understand it now? God the Father is not a man. The Holy Spirit is not a man. He's a spirit. And God the Father is also what? He's a spirit. Anyone that will worship him must worship him in truth and in spirit. But Jesus has the spirit components and the what? The man comes. So when you go to heaven, when you go to heaven, when you see Jesus, you will touch his body. Yes. His body is real in heaven. The Bible calls him the firstborn among the dead. He's the one, the first person to resurrect from the dead, having his spirit and body intact, is the first person. When you go to heaven, you will find saints of God, but their body is where? They left their body on earth. Do you understand it? this dimension high. Don't worry, consults. Praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. When Jesus resurrected, he told them, say, come and touch my flesh and see that it's real. I'm not a spirit. A spirit cannot eat. Jesus ate with them. Praise the Lord. That was possible because Jesus is the mediator between God and man. The principal driver of God's program on earth today is the Holy Spirit. He is who? He is the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is our guide into all the purposes of God on earth, especially with regards to the salvation of humanity and the systemic redemption of the physical earth. If you want to create an invention today, maybe you are a scientist and you are praying, Spirit of God, direct me as I create this invention. Would the Holy Spirit answer you? Will he answer you? You're not talking. He will answer you, but it will not be as much as when you are praying for the salvation of men's souls. I don't know whether that's my point. I'm trying to say that when it comes to spiritual and scientific things, God is more interested in what? The spiritual things. But at the same time, he will still operate with you on other aspects of your life. But he will give priority to the salvation of souls. So, the Holy Spirit is the principal driver of God's program on earth. That means that the kind of relationship we should have with God today should be very real, because the Holy Spirit is with us. Is the Holy Spirit here? Is he here? Where is he? In the office or where? He's inside. He's not by your side. He's inside. Praise the Lord. Unless you've blocked the room of your heart. The Holy Spirit is resident. Anywhere you go, he's there. Angels on. The angels of God are the ministering spirits that carry out the biddings of the Father from heaven to. We quickly look at some of their duties. Protection. Angels, according to Psalm 91 verse 11, it said he shall give his angels charge to do what? To keep you. To not allow your feet to be dashed on a stone. You are walking. Angels will just push you a little bit and your leg will skip that stone. Okay, no, those ones. The Holy Spirit is inside you. Angels are by your side. And they also carry out the work of provision. They are not the one providing for you, but they carry provision from heaven to give to you. Sometimes you'll be in a condition, you'll see a person. You don't know from anywhere. You just say, take. It's like you don't have transport. Thank you, sir. Before you turn, you can't see the person again. He's gone. He has finished his work. Angels are real. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 2 tells us that be careful. You may entertain angels without knowing. That's what the Bible says. You can entertain angels without knowing. You won't know. I had a story of somebody in this town whose encounter with somebody who appears to be like an angel changed his financial fortune. He's doing so well today. I'm sure some of you must have heard of the hospital they call Save a Life. Save a Life Hospital. The man met somebody in a plane, giving contacts to call, people to call, to ask for assistance. That was the last time he met the man. And those contacts changed his life. Praise the Lord. Angels are real. Angels also help in supporting us. They also participate in the work of deliverance. The deliverance ministry. You are in a very terrible situation. Angels can deliver you. Like the story of Peter in prison. God sent an angel to go and what? To go and rescue him. Because as at that situation, no man will be able to rescue Peter. But an angel went. And then the work of encouragement. Information. Sometimes an angel will appear and tell you certain things you don't know. Companionship and intervention. These are some of the activities of angels in scriptures. The legislators of the kingdom. Heaven has a settled constitution that governs heaven and earth. However, God has given us the liberty to determine what should happen on the earth space. Do you understand that? Heaven's constitution is what? Settled. You can't update it. You can't review it. It's settled in heaven. But when it comes to the earth, God has given us liberty to determine what will happen here. And that's why we are called legislators of the kingdom. It is our responsibility to make legislations, decrees, orders, commands that will shape the earth to become more like heaven. Kingdom citizens or kingdom ambassadors are meant to be the legislators of the kingdom of God on here on earth. The Bible says, you shall decree a thing and it shall be what? It shall be established. The Bible went on to say, if two of you shall agree as touching any matter under heaven, it shall be what? Done. The Bible also went further to say that whatsoever you decree on earth, it shall be established. That's what it is. Legislators of the kingdom. What does it mean? It means that a lot of the things happening on the earth is because we have not what? We have not legislated. The National Assembly, when they meet, one of the things they do is they pass bills. People bring, they suggest bills, they give them to their senators. The senators go there and say, no, there should be a bill that should end school fees for all children below the age of 10. Any child that is below 10 years old should not pay school fees. The government's duty is to pay school fees. so many legislations. So when I talk of legislations, apart from the physical government part, I'm also talking about the spiritual realm. A man called John Knox. No, I think I'm mixing him up. I think it should be Charles G. Finney. After Charles G. Finney died in England, 100 years after he died, they were not selling alcohol in his town. If you go there and you ask for alcohol, they will ask you that, haven't you had? Alcohol is not allowed. Do you know that even as recent as 1930s, alcohol was banned in America? Do you know that? Eh? Alcohol was banned at a point in the U.S. You don't know the gravity of that. Why? Because as at that time, there were apostles who legislated. Now, when the apostles began to sleep, what happened? They repealed the ban. You know what it means to repeal a law? It means that you take out the restriction. Say, no, don't worry. We said there should be no sale of alcohol, but please, you can go ahead. The same America that has legislated LGBT laws, lesbian, gay, transgender, and bisexual laws, at one time banned it. Are you seeing it now? Praise the Lord. Please look up here. What I'm saying is the fact that your country has banned a law today does not mean they will not repeal it tomorrow. And that's the reason why you must be awake. You must be alert. It is your duty to monitor what is going on in the National Assembly. Are you listening to me? Don't be the kind of Christian who read Bible and don't listen to news. Your Bible says watch and it make you watch TV. When you watch TV, finish, pray. Watch, there actually means be observant. Be watchful. Be sober. Be sensitive. That's what it means. And for you to be sensitive in our society, listen to news. You must know what is happening. Have you seen Buhari before? I never seen Buhari. Now here they hear. So now news. Praise the Lord. So we need people that will be watchdogs for the kingdom of God. We need people whose duty will say, I want to watch what is happening to young girls. I want to know what is happening to them, and I want to care for them. Praise the Lord. I want to care for them. Don't just be a Christian who is totally oblivious of what is happening around you. You just pray, be filled with the Holy Ghost, and you are sitting there. You'll be a useless Christian. A Christian that God is not interested in. The Bible says that God told Abraham, he said, will I hide what I'm about to do, seeing that Abraham will teach his children, will bring them up to become God-fearing. I won't hide. That means if you are a responsible Christian, when God wants to do things, what will he do? He will tell you. And many times things happen in the country. God tells me, I tell my wife, I say, this one is going to happen. You don't come again. I said, no, just watch out. Now I'm telling you the truth. God will give you access to revelation. And not just revelation of what is happening globally. I'm talking about revelation even when it comes to investment. Where you should invest. What you should not invest in. Sometimes they will come with one business proposal. It's so lucrative. Everybody's entering. God said, don't enter. And you hear before you know it. When MMM came, a lot of people entered it. They say, oh, enter now. Many people came to meet me. Enter. I said, me. I'll be the last person. Why? Because felt an uneasiness about it. And they didn't say, a lot of pastors put their money there. People that are blind spiritually. Praise the Lord. So, in terms of our society, we need to become legislators. Let us take charge of our society. If you hear the kind of prayers we pray here, you will know that we are legislators. We're not just people who want to use God and get a blessing. Praise the Lord. We'll be rounding up in a moment. Executors of the will of God, the execution of the will of God on earth, on the earth realm, has always been delegated to man since creation. God is a speaking God. Are you listening to me? When God speaks, what happens? His word goes into operation. Now, there are dimensions of what God says. It is our responsibility to carry it out. The word has already been spoken. It's hanging. We need to carry it out. I will show you that. Praise the Lord. Genesis chapter 1 verse 26 says that let us make man in our own image. Let him have dominion. And then he went on to say that let him what? Let him subdue the earth. And in 2 verse 5, it says, there was no man to till the ground. And so God had not caused it to rain. Did you see that? God did not want to waste the rain because there was no man to till the ground. And then in verse 15, he now planted man and gave him responsibility. He says, dress the garden, tend the garden, keep it. Do you see that? Praise the Lord. It's important for us to understand that the will of God on earth, you and I have the responsibility to what? To execute it. While we carry out God's will and purposes on earth, concerning every aspect of life, we are sometimes assisted by angels, especially where and when we are naturally limited. We get the assistance of angels when we have natural limitation, but principally God has ordained us to execute his will. That is why he said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. When the Bible says go into all the world and preach the gospel, there's so many things that are inside. It means preach, teach, heal, liberate, disciple, mentor, pastor, coach people into the will of God. Praise the Lord. The slides are available on our Facebook page, so it's always there. If you are focused on writing all through the service, you won't benefit as much. Just take some jottings. It's on Facebook. I think, did we share it on the WhatsApp? We can also put it on the WhatsApp too. Praise the Lord. So we have the propagation of the kingdom of God. We're about to, I think just a few slides will be done. The kingdom of God is primarily propagated through the preaching and the gospel of Jesus Christ, especially with the resultant conversion of a sinner to a saint. Just as it is in the physical procreation mechanism, humans play their biological parts without knowing the intricate workings of how children are formed in the womb. So it is in the propagation of the gospel. We go out to preach to a soul, and the Holy Spirit convicts and converts the soul. The same way a man impregnates a woman and a child is formed. You don't even know how it happens. Spiritually speaking, when you go out to preach the gospel, you don't know how it happens. Please, let him not make noise. Praise the Lord. So, also, when you go out to preach the gospel, you share the message. You don't know what is going on in the heart of the person, but you have sown the word. The Holy Spirit convicts the person, and the person gets saved. How many of you have gone out for evangelism, and the person you spent 2 hours preaching to, he didn't even receive Jesus? Meanwhile, the other person who, before you spoke 30 minutes, he's, can you lead me to Christ? Praise the Lord. So it is not a human effort. It is not by human effort, but by the workings of the Holy Spirit. Also, all the spiritual resources required to carry out the work of propagation of the kingdom of God has been supplied by the Holy Spirit. Paul the Apostle said, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. Praise the Lord. Secondly, the propagation of the kingdom of God is achieved by procreation. I summarized it. I said, preaching, teaching, mentoring, discipleship, procreation, parenting. These are means by which we propagate the kingdom of God. Do you know, as a parent, you have two souls with you already? Two souls that you need to lead to heaven. If you give birth to 20 children, you have 20 souls to lead to heaven. It's your duty. And God, that's why, I like it very much when we attended Dan's dedication. I like what the father said. He said, we are caretakers as a parent. So when God gives you children, if you don't have any soul, that is already what? Souls for his kingdom. It's your duty to bring them up. If every one of us decide that we're not going to get married, we're not going to have children, do you know the kingdom of God will suffer? Do you know that? Who gave man the mandate to procreate? Who? God. An instruction. He said, be fruitful. God established the institution of marriage. So as much as we're trying to do family planning, praise the Lord. Please, encourage your children to get married. And let them marry, let men marry women, and women marry men. Please, teach them this tradition established by God. Because if we stop, the kingdom of God will suffer. When humans pray for deliverance, God sends a child. Wasn't Jesus a child when he came? He was a child. Paul the Apostle. Everybody that has ever done anything on the earth came as a child. So every child you see is a potential, is on a potential assignment for God. Praise the Lord. I spent almost 2 or 3 hours downloading videos of American Got Talent, young people singing. And when I watch these videos, tears come out of my eyes because I see varieties of talents. You see people with a baritone voice, with a tenor, the soprano, all of them. There is none of them that is just so important that others are not important. No, everybody is important. Everybody. Your gift, if you know your value of your gift, you will know that mine is not more important than yours. Praise the Lord. But a lot of times we envy people, thinking that they have better gifts. When you see my body now, what you actually see, you see my eyes, my nose, and all of those things. But do you know that these ones that are being showcased are no more important than the ones that you don't see? My liver, you don't see it. But without my liver, I won't stand here. But I can stand here without my eyes. Do you understand that? Some gifts of God are such that you may not even see them in operation, but they are more important. Or they are very important. So, have the opportunity to preach. Please preach. That's how to propagate the kingdom of God. If you have the opportunity to teach, please teach. When I was going for youth service, I was seriously dreaming to teach so that I can minister to a lot of souls. Because when you teach as a teacher, you have all the opportunity to preach to your students. For me, I think it's the best avenue you can ever have to teach. I work as an engineer, and I have a lot of people who come to do jobs. And whenever they are doing the job, because I'm the supervisor, I preach. I talk about the kingdom of God, and they all listen. They have to listen because I'm supervising their job. I don't know if I understand my point. So God gives us the opportunity in whatever we do to what? Influence people. You can mentor people. You can encourage people. Facebook instead of you to use it to discuss APC and PDP or Arsenal and Man U, you can talk about the gospel. Sometimes, you know, when you taught me this status thing, I just put status and people just, hey, thank God, bless the Lord, you know, for what you share. It's an amazing thing. Every avenue. In fact, many years ago, I said I was going to design something at the back of my car that will be sharing the gospel. As you are driving, a car following you behind, people will be reading the gospel. It will be like a small screen. Huh? God is a good God. He's caring and loving. And you see everybody reading it. Who are you? Because it's on your car. Any avenue, right? You can print a t-shirt. I'm crazy for Jesus. Just walk. You have already shared the gospel. Praise the Lord. Let's do a lot of creative things to share this gospel. You want to do a birthday? Why are you wasting it? It's an opportunity. They want to come and chop your cake. They will chop it for you. They will hear the gospel. That's the truth. Everything that we do, we can always to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you believe that there is a hell, there is a hell, that people who don't accept Jesus Christ will go to hell, you will preach. You will preach. Many times we don't believe, saying, this God, I know, and the last day we just talk, say, sorry, oh, there's no hell, I just use that to deceive una. Do you think that's what will happen? Hey, Jesus. The word hell occurs over 200 times in the New Testament, and about 150 of them was by Jesus only. Only Jesus. And he went as far as saying that there are worms, the worms in hell don't die, and the fire is not quenched. I don't know which kind of figurative expression those things mean. They were real. Praise the Lord. The concept of shared responsibility. I don't know whether we'll talk about this or we just pray here. I will just pray. I won't go through it. But what it simply means is that for every blessing, every thing that we're going to experience on earth, we have a part to play. That's what it simply means. Everything you want God to do for you, there is a part to play. If you want to receive anything from God, at least you must ask. Isn't it? Huh? So that's the administrative style of God. He calls us into partnership with Him. God does not want to run. You know, I told us before that theocracy, God, the government of God by God for God. But He has gone a step further to say, I want to share my government with you. I want us to run this government together. Jesus chose 12 disciples. And those 12 disciples in turn chose others. We are disciples of disciples of disciples of disciples of disciples of Jesus and of God, isn't it? That's how we are. At least I know some of you are my disciples in a way. But I am a disciple of somebody. And that person is also a disciple, isn't it? When you read W. Kenyon's book, you are momentarily a disciple of Kenyon. And he was also a disciple of somebody. So we are all disciples of Jesus. Paul the Apostle said, be ye followers of me as I'm full of Christ. So salvation is free, but you must believe it to receive it. You must believe. Sanctification is free, but you must desire it to receive it. Baptism with the Holy Spirit is a free gift of God, but you must ask for it. The manifestation of the power of God is given freely by God, but you must seek for it in prayer. The presence of God is freely given to us, but you must seek for it diligently. The anointing is freely given, but you must what? Prepare for it. There is always a part to play. As a matter of fact, find one promise of God in the Bible. I'm giving you that challenge that does not have a condition. Every promise of God in the Bible has a condition. I didn't say some, I said every. I'm giving you that assignment. Go and find one that does not have a condition. There's always something you must do to receive what God is giving to you. And it's not money. It's not giving Him money. Money is not part of it. God divided the Red Sea, but Moses had to do what? He had to stretch for the sand. He had to. what was his name? Naaman was to be cured of his leprosy. What did they ask him to do? Huh? They said, enter the water and bathe 7 times. The guy got angry. He said, we have better waters in my country. Why will I enter this dirty Israel water? Somebody came to me and said, you get sense at all? They didn't ask you for money. They just said, enter this water 7 times and that's your problem. The guy said, I'm sorry. And when he entered, what happened? Let's rise up to pray. Every blessing of God. Well, we just took time to look at the nature of the kingdom of God. We'll look at some of the practices, some of the principles, some of the composition, things that will affect how we relate with God. And of all the things that we've learned today, if I will highlight, I will say that the principle of shared leadership or shared responsibility is very important. Many of the things that we're trusting God to receive is just for us to play our part and it will show up. It's just for us to play our part. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, it says, I will hear. God never delays. He never tells you come tomorrow. If you are ready today, you will receive it today. No man that cometh unto me that I will cast away. That's what he said. This evening I want you to begin to talk to God and say, Lord, I open my heart to you. I open my heart to the nature of the kingdom. I receive this teaching. I receive this message. Let it be the change driver in my life. Let it influence every aspect of my life going forward. Starting from this month of April that we are entering tomorrow, let me begin to experience a supernatural dimension of the Father. A supernatural dimension of the Father. A supernatural dimension of the Father. Lord, I want to know you. I want to feel you. I want to experience you. I want to be one with you. I want to experience everything that is in your word concerning my life. Every blessing that has been spoken over my life, I receive grace to bet it in my life. I want to see the result of the cross of Calvary in my life. I want to experience Jesus. I want to experience Jesus in my life. I want to experience Jesus in my life. In Jesus' name we pray. All God wants us to do is to accept Him. Just believe in Him. One word that defines Christianity is belief, faith. You just believe. Believe in Him. Believe whatever He's saying to you is possible. It's possible. It's possible. Praise the Lord. One of the methods that is used in hospitals to treat people is what they call detoxification. Detoxification is removal of poisonous substances from your body. You go to the hospital, they start giving you certain medications. What happens? You start going to toilets. You probably may even vomit. And they tell you that it's part of the process so that whatever that is wrong in your system comes out. Many times, the wrong things that we have had is what is stopping us from receiving what God is saying to us. I want you to pray and say, Lord, detoxify me. Detoxify me. Remove every wrong teaching, every wrong preaching that perhaps has so made me believe that I can do things by myself without the help of God. Or that God will do everything without playing any part. Lord, remove every of such negative perception, every of such negative mindset. Help me that I will be able to allow you walk upon my life, walk upon my heart, direct my life, direct every aspect of everything that I do. Spirit of God, walk upon me, walk upon me, walk upon me in the name of Jesus. Walk upon me in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. When this year began, can we look up? I asked us to write what we are expecting from God. I don't know how many of us did that. How many of you carried out that assignment? I said you should write what you are expecting from God. Okay, you didn't carry out the assignment. Raise your hand. No, because you can't hang on the fence now. Did you carry out the assignment? Do you even know the assignment? The assignment, write what you are expecting from God. What you want God to do for you in 2019 is also related to what are your plans for 2019 that you want God to help you achieve them. Did you do any of them? Huh? You did. Okay, so put up your hand now. Praise the Lord. You didn't do any of that. You've done this year now. You've done that. You don't do that now. It must not be Ocean of Grace. Now, Ocean of Grace, the marker. Have you done your assignment? Praise the Lord. Now, why is it important? It's one of the secrets of receiving. The expectations of your heart will not be cut short. When there is an expectation, you move God to work in your life. It's a principle of faith. When you are expecting nothing, you will get nothing. Ask and you shall receive. I don't want this year 2019 to be a year of struggle for you. Because honestly, the way I see this year, before June, I've literally gotten all I want from 2019. The remaining Ajara, I don't know about you. I don't know about you. I'm just telling you, by June, I am okay. The rest is Jara. And so that's, I want the same thing to happen to you even much more. Whatever your expectations are, let it happen before the middle of the year. In the name of Jesus. As we round up our fast today, I want you to begin to trust God and say, Father, that which I committed to you in prayer concerning 2019, Father, go ahead and establish it. Go ahead and fulfill it. Open your mouth and begin to pray. Open your mouth and begin to pray. That which I've committed to your hand concerning 2019, my expectations for 2019, go ahead and establish it. Go ahead and establish it in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and pray. Father, I make demand that every expectations of my heart, every expectations of my heart in 2019, everything that I've written down, everything that I have put down together in the place of prayer and say, Lord, grant it. Concerning my life, concerning Ocean of Grace, concerning Silk, concerning JCA World, concerning other aspects of my life, oh God, I ask that you will accomplish them. You will bring them to pass. You will actualize them in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth and pray. When you fast and you don't pray, it's hunger strike. Father, I pray that this year 2019, before June, my biggest breakthrough will come. My biggest breakthrough will come. My biggest breakthrough will come. The expectations of my heart, the silent desires that is in my heart that I cannot even express according to your word and according to your will, they will come to pass in the name of Jesus. I make demand that this year, Lord, before June, before the end of this quarter, a bumper breakthrough, access to unlimited supernatural breakthrough in the name of Jesus. That is my heart desire. That is my longing. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Begin to pray for everyone that was supposed to be here today. Say, Lord, reach out to our members wherever they are. They were supposed to be in church today. Lord, whatever challenges they have, solve it. Solve it. Meet them at the point of their need. Open your mouth and pray. The Bible says, as soon as Job prayed for his friends, the Lord turned his captivity around. Pray for your friends. Pray for your neighbors. Pray for your colleagues. Pray that the Lord will turn their own captivity around. Whatever challenges, they will receive hope. They will receive solution. They will receive answers. In the name of Jesus, every one of our members, Lord, we pray that you will attend to their needs, attend to their issues, strengthen them and empower them, so that the next time we gather, they will all be here. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Father, we ask that you will cause the word of God that we have received today to fall on good ground. Let it fall on good ground. Let it bring forth fold, 60-fold, 100-fold, in the name of Jesus. We pray that as we have learned about the nature of the kingdom, especially with regards to shared responsibility, we will understand that it is not up to you, but it is up to us, for us to take the right steps that we ought to take to see you move in our favor. Let that be our portion in the name of Jesus. Lord, as we step into the month of April, let miracles begin to greet us from the very first day. In the name of Jesus, every expectations of our hearts in line with your word, let them come to pass. In the name of Jesus, Father, show us your favor in the month of April. Show us your favor in the month of April. As you said to us, let it be a season, the beginning of the season of supernatural divine rains. Rains of favor. Rains of increase. Rains of promotion. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.